To all who come to this reasonably content place, welcome. I'm some jerk with a camera.
Universal hates itself. No, seriously, Universal hates itself. Oh, sure, they try to act confident. After all, they're one of only two Hollywood studios with the guts to get into the theme park business. Permanently. Domestically. Consensually. But beneath that veneer of confidence, Universal knows it's but a shell of itself. A fraud, a phony, a charlatan that can't handle the theme park business alone.
Depression is a terrible disease like any other, and if corporations are people, it stands to reason they develop the ailments of regular people. I mean, it's got all the symptoms. Weight gain, mood swings,
roll back to the dawn of time when the earth was smoking and the lava flowed.
Denial.
And abusive behavior towards loved ones. Not to mention, the only movies they've ever made about theme parks have been disaster movies where everything goes horribly wrong and hundreds of tourists get killed!
Universal, can you identify this corpse?
Are we there yet?
No.
Are we there yet?
No.
Are we there yet?
No.
How did this theme park develop such intense self-loathing? Well, I dare say standing in the shadow of a rodent would make anyone feel small. Disneyland is the happiest place on a planet, Universal is that planet, but somehow it's only the entertainment capital of a city it's not even technically in. Disney has always been little mouse perfect, hasn't it? It hooks the masses in their youth and follows them to their graves, with parks that rely almost entirely on properties Disney owns, or buys out eventually. Disney is the beautiful, pure, perfect Princess Molly Ringwald, while Universal...
I'm a nymphomaniac.
...gets in bed with any intellectual property that'll have it, including ones Disney buys out! And lately, it's gotten so depressed that it's decided to just stay in and play video games. Then it slaps its own logo on a park with all that stuff, as if to say, yeah, but they're really Universal movies. They were all made on planet Earth, right? And that's us, so they're ours.
I'm not a nymphomaniac. I'm a compulsive liar.
Are we there yet?
No.
Are we there yet?
No.
Are we there yet?
No!
And that's the root of this park's depression. It knows that, objectively, it doesn't really have a reason to exist. I mean, think about it. It's not that strong a brand name. Kids don't watch the Universal Channel. The Nostalgia Critic doesn't do Universember. And whenever Universal somehow does stumble upon its own successful franchise that kids are really into, it has this annoying habit of
squeezing every last drop of life out of that franchise like Lenny stroking a puppy too hard!
Oh, it's coming. Someday, when the 2010s are but a nostalgic memory, and the kids of today pause for a moment from staring into the depressing abyss of adulthood to finally remember those wacky Despicable Me movies they used to go see, this will still be standing, confusing the hell out of their kids. Oh, you don't believe me? Tell you what, right now go to Universal Florida and ask the kids playing at Fievel's Playland who the fuck Fievel is. But I'm sure those of you who read this link before clicking on it are asking, what does any of this have to do with The Simpsons?
Are we there yet?
No!
Are we there yet?
No!
Are we there yet?
No!
When Back to the Future the ride closed, I was sorry to see it go, but it wasn't really a surprise. That 2015 scene was literally getting less futuristic every day. Still, there was no reason why they couldn't just update the ride like Disney updated Star Tours. It's still one of their most beloved franchises ever, and Christopher Lloyd is still alive and working. Hell, he still plays Doc Brown every now and then. But for some reason, Universal completely lost faith in one of the most celebrated stories it ever brought to the screen. The ride that helped put the park on the map wasn't good enough anymore once the cool kids expressed interest. Universal hated itself so much it gutted an e-ticket all its own so it could pay royalties to Rupert Murdoch, who, by the way, would also get in bed with the enemy 1 year later, all for another theme park disaster movie with the narrative that theme parks are death traps. It would have been nice if The Simpsons and Back to the Future could have coexisted in peace and harmony, with Bart and Marty skateboarding together off into the sunset. But...
nobody calls me yellow.
Seriously, have you noticed how many yellow characters Universal has? It's weird, right? Is yellow just an appealing color, or are the executives secretly yellow supremacists or something? I don't know. Anyway, ever since the salad days of Do the Bartman, the Simpsons have been courted for theme park rights by various parties. Even Disney offered to exploit them for a cheap character meet and greet show at Disney MGM, but the show's producers wisely knew they deserved better.
Marketing the Simpsons on t-shirts and mugs, yeah, we could do that. But it would be wrong.
They were sitting on arguably the greatest lead-in the Sinbad show ever had, and they knew it. And they refused to be bought out for anything less than a genuine, bona fide, electrified six-car ride of some sort. The exact number of cars was negotiable. And James L. Brooks has maintained the same policy on all his shows.
Whoa! Taxi simulator! It feels like I'm really looking at a taxi! This is awesome! Wow! The 3D's amazing! It's like I'm really looking at Danny DeVito's name! Woo! Mary Lou Henner!
For no reason at all, I'll suddenly see something happening in the future and it usually comes true.
Finally, Gracie Films signed with
SeaWorld?
No.
Disney World?
Uh-uh.
Gator World?
Afraid not.
Universal Studios?
Stupid Lisa!
Christopher Lloyd was replaced by Dan Castellaneta, again, as our favorite family moved into the motion simulators in Doc Brown's Omnimax domes. Because, you know, last time they were under a dome went so well for them. And the Simpsons ride was born! Though, of course, any authentic Simpsons ride would go on about three times too long and throw in a few too many guest stars.
Literally no reason why they couldn't just bring back to the... Letting it go.
Originally, they wanted to base the ride's story around a field trip to the nuclear power plant, which would have fit the look of the Institute much better. Hell, they could have even made those giant IMAX buildings look like the cooling towers. But voice actor Harry Shearer apparently demanded too much money for Universal's liking, and no Harry Shearer means no Mr. Burns, no Smithers, no Skinner, no Otto, no Flanders, no Lovejoy, no Hibbert, no Jasper, no Kent Brockman, no Herman, no God, and perhaps most tragic of all... No Lenny.
Not Lenny!
And since you'd need at least half of those for a proper field trip to the power plant episode, the new premise is that Krusty the Clown bought the Institute of Future Technology and turned it into Krustyland, a massive indoor theme park. Geez, not even Disney can make that work. And we're all about to partake in its signature ride, along with this randomly selected average suburban family. An astronaut, an ex-con, a future president, a baby who shot a man, and the I Didn't Do It kid.
And you can pick one other group to come with you.
How about these guys?
Sure, whatever. They look clean.
Are you?
And the 8-passenger DeLoreans have now been transformed into the most terrifyingly dangerous vehicles in the history of mankind. Vehicles controlled by Kelsey Grammer.
Sideshow Bob is featured in this ride. He pretty much is the ride.
That's right. Krusty's age-old nemesis has once again escaped from tossing salads and scrambling eggs in prison to commandeer Krustiversal Studios.
What do you want?
A dish best served cold. Is it ice cream? No, revenge!
In other words, Kelsey Grammer, the third highest paid actor in the history of television, apparently demanded less money for this than the bassist from Spinal Tap.
If I told them once, I told them 100 times to put bassist from Spinal Tap first and Simpsons Ride last.
It's a morale builder, isn't it?
Incidentally, Harry Shearer also refused to participate in either of these commercials. One due to schedule conflicts, and the other because he found out the product can cause leukemia. See if you can guess which is which!
Coming this summer to Cedar Point, just outside Cleveland.
Hello, Cleveland!
This is Spinal Tap, the ride! Walk through a queue that looks just like a confusing backstage area. Gaze in amazement at the animatronic janitor giving directions. And then ride, literally no ride! This is Spinal Tap, the lack of ride, coming only to Hard Rock Park.
Derek Smalls is now played by Kelsey Grammer. The Simpsons ride opened on both coasts in May of 2008 and immediately became one of the top two carnival-themed rides to open on both coasts that summer based on an iconic cartoon from the 90s and involving a character Kelsey Grammer voiced. Weird.
I'm gonna hide you where there's no one around for miles. Disney's California Adventure.
The queue perfectly captures the look and feel of a cheap Springfieldian theme park, right down to dressing all the cast members as Waldo. And they put the word sideshow on everyone's shirt because originally they wanted it on everyone's name tag.
Here's how that conversation went with the name tag peoples.
Sideshow's not a name?
Yeah, but all of Krusty's sidekicks have Sideshow before their names. Sideshow Bob, Sideshow Mel, Sideshow Luke Perry. It'd be fun to continue that tradition.
But Sideshow's not a name.
I know, but the idea is that this is Krusty's theme park.
Name tags are for names. Sideshow's not a name.
If you could just open your mind the tiniest.
We could put it on a shirt. Shirt could say anything.
Okay, shirt department. Instead of name tags, could we put Sideshow name on every shirt?
You want the word Sideshow name on 500 shirts?
Yeah. No, every shirt should have a different name. You can't make every shirt different, you brainless clod. They're not name tags.
Yeah, you can't not have name tags. How else would you tag names?
I know. We'll put Sideshow on the shirts and the name on the name tags.
Right, because Sideshow's not a name.
That kind of defeats the purpose.
Or we could change everyone's name to Bort. You're fired.
You can't fire me without name tags. Everyone's nameless.
Damn it, you're right. You bested me for the last time, Mr.
What was your name again? Sideshow Johnson.
I hate you. But I digress, which is unlike me, I know. The thing is, there's really not much to mock in this ride. I'm not kidding, folks. Content-wise, this is by far the funniest ride I've ever been on. It was written by the show's actual writing staff, and it doesn't take itself even remotely seriously, so there's really nothing for me to satirically push against.
This ride makes fun of itself at every turn. Even if I tried, well...
Simpsons did it.
So like any true citizen of the internet, I know that whenever I lack sufficient brain capacity to make fun of something, there's only one thing left to do.
Nitpick it.
Some jerk with a camera presents the top 11 nitpickings about the Simpsons ride!
Why top 11? Because I like to go the worst step beyond ever!
I'm Kent Brockman on the 11 o'clock news tonight. A certain kind of soft drink has been found to be lethal.
The layout of Krusty Land is remarkably similar to that of the former Institute. And these ride vehicles look remarkably like the 8-passenger DeLoreans. They even have gullwing doors for some reason. It's almost as though they just painted over everything.
Park still looks fake.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
But no, you had to be 10.
They shut down Back to the Future for the 2015 scene, but they don't mind showing this joke in 2015.
Home of the Whiplash!
To be completed in 1994.
Just keeps getting funnier and funnier.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
$900 dues!
This ride is neither the first nor last appearance of Krusty Land.
Those tourists were decapitated before they entered the Krusty Land House of Knives.
For the past 15 years, I was president of Euro Krusty Land. Until it blew up.
They've even visited the place on the actual show since this ride opened, so technically, Krusty Land is canon. It was also a level on that weird early Simpsons arcade game where Smithers kidnapped Maggie and you had to chase him through Krusty Land, and there were all these... The hell am I looking at?
Hi, we're clones of Troy McClure. You might remember us from such battle tactics as using an umbrella and evaporating at the touch of a hammer.
And as if that weren't enough, there is also a Krusty Land comic book.
You'll never take me alive!
In this three-issue series from the mid-90s, Krusty builds a cheap theme park in less than a month to settle a debt with the Mafia. But the land is cursed or something, and everything goes horribly wrong, and it's destroyed on opening day. It was poorly drawn and not easy to follow, but it existed! And best as I can tell, Sideshow Bob is not in it!
Frankly, I'm surprised. In 572 episodes, the series has not made a single continuity error. And yet the ride, the game, and the comic book all tell very different stories. So which one really happened?
None of them!
You're all dead to me.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
Number eight. Number eight. Number eight.
Let's meet the inventor, Dr. Nick Riviera.
Hello, Toy. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Dr. Nick.
Toy, you like a glass of orange juice?
No one else ever does it.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
This is a magic seven.
Then Bob tried to frame me for robbery, and he was foiled by the Simpsons.
What the? He was foiled by Bart. Bart figured the whole thing out.
I didn't do it.
Yes, you did. The family never even believed you until Bob's third episode.
I didn't do it.
Yes, you did. You cracked the case wide open.
I didn't do it.
I admire your modesty, but I have animated evidence.
I didn't do it.
Of...
I didn't do it.
I'm
trying.
I didn't
do it. I didn't do it. I didn't do it.
It's a compliment.
I didn't do it. I didn't do it. I didn't do it. I didn't do it.
Wait,
I didn't
I'm trying.
Do it.
Yes, you did.
Shut up! If you're gonna be this difficult, then so help me.
Wait.
Nope. Too late.
Don't do it.
Oh, I'm doing it. I will have a cow.
Yes.
I said cow!
Cows don't look like cows on film. You gotta use horses.
Fine, I'll have a horse instead. Come on, princess.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
We're under six.
And I'm a college student.
Wow, we're the first people to ever ride this baby. We're like that space guy who did that moon thing.
Neil Armstrong?
No, Chewbacca!
I believe I've made it abundantly clear that despite what certain pre-shows would have you believe, Chewbacca rides nothing! Would you care for some fresh ground pepper in that wound now that you've salted it? I bit my Neil Armstrong.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
Nichols had pictures of bumblebees on him! Give me 5 bees for a quarter, you'd say.
Why are the pre-show clips all normal two-dimensional animation as God intended, while the ride film is all CGI? Dear God, I look like a Smurf with jaundice.
Once we went up into the dome, we wanted to get the completely immersive experience, and I think bringing the CG look to it was paramount to that.
Wrong studio, moron.
That'll teach you to answer my question reasonably.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
I'm seeing double here. 4 Krusties!
There's a weird dialogue variant between the two coasts.
Homie, they sent a Stacy there!
Oh, that's a load of corporate...
Homie, they sent a Stacy there!
Oh, that's a load of...
And this line was apparently changed before the ride even opened.
A fate worse than death. A kiddie ride.
At least we're safe.
A kiddie ride.
At least we're safe.
So apparently Florida is anti-corporate and both parks are anti-death? No wonder they couldn't get Mr. Burns.
It's Kern, stupid!
No, it's not!
Disregard.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
They sent the toaster to 3! Medium brown!
One remnant from the power plant draft is a climax where nuclear radiation causes Maggie to grow giant-sized. And when it happens, the Simpsons... just go home and wait for their baby to be killed by the military or something. But then their couch turns into a ride vehicle and the aliens show up, because why wouldn't they? I'm aware they're turning the action into a couch gag, but those are permitted to flex the show's reality because they're not part of the episode proper. For such a weird twist to end a Simpsons adventure, especially one involving Homer getting run over, a giant robot panda, Lisa riding a whale, a Honey I Blew Up the Kid ripoff, and a literal trip to hell...
Well, I just have to say it. Verisimilitude compromised! Yeah.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
Wow, 2!
Yeah, 2.
I completely ripped off my previous statement from my Captain EO review.
Verisimilitude compromised!
That gives me an idea.
Hi, I'm Captain EO.
Hi, I was captain of a monorail once.
We're going in.
Uh-oh.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
Number one! What kind of stupid wiener name is that? Hello, my name is Number One.
And so forth.
I still got 5 seconds to kill somebody. Hello, folks.
What a horrible nightmare.
Right before that couch crushed him, he totally should have stepped on a rake.
Hello, folks.
What a horrible nightmare.
You are not pandering to me correctly, you ride, you. I hope everyone got fired for that blunder. I command more firings for my amusement. I am the internet. I am...
I like the Simpsons ride.
No, we hate the Simpsons ride.
I love the Simpsons ride.
Not only is this hands down my favorite ride in the park, I dare say it's worth the admission price alone. If you enjoy intense motion simulators and you're not completely dead inside, this is absolutely positively not to be missed. In fact, the only thing that could possibly make it even cooler is a Halloween Horror Nights makeover as a Treehouse of Horror ride. They can even bring back Homer's toaster and do Back to the Future again. I can dream, can't I?
And now, at long last, we can finally reveal for absolute certain that Springfield is located in the state of California. And Florida. And Illinois and Missouri and Massachusetts and all those others, technically.
Where the hell's the ride?
A couple years ago, Florida opened an expanded Springfield area all around the ride, and just last month, Hollywood followed suit with some of the finest artery-clogging eateries this side of Shelbyville. At last, we poor, pathetic, real people can drink at Moe's, eat at Krusty Burger, and... Christ, they'll give a small business loan to anyone these days.
Hey! Kids, we're
selling
dinner tonight!
Wow, the Simpsons in a chicken joint. Just imagine it.
Hey, OJ, you sure enjoy that Golden Pioneer chicken.
Oh, yeah, I love it. As much as I love Pioneer's New Country Spicy Chicken.
Buy a 10-piece bucket of Pioneer chicken and get a free kids ticket to Universal Studios Tour.
Wait a minute. The real killer was the other OJ! They even finally built the power plant! As a decorative backdrop where you can push a button and cause a horrible meltdown.
And I don't want to alarm you, but I think all this radiation has started to mutate the people of Springfield. Some of them have even grown a fifth finger on each hand. Fortunately, I'm protected against a...
Don't look at me! But what I really admire about the Simpsons ride is the finesse with which it has its forbidden donut and eats it too. You might remember my review of Roseanne's Disney World episode and how their attempt at a Disney satire in their next episode was torpedoed by a single line.
This place wants to be Disney World, but it's just some creepy fascist copy.
Here, in an actual theme park, you don't get such aggressive compromise. If anything, you get the sweetest, crispiest, crunchiest, peanut butteriest kind of subtle compromise.
You see, to an entire generation, The Simpsons wasn't just a TV show. It was the TV show. Not just for the humor or the characters or the animation, though all were exemplary, but also for how it ingeniously used TV to comment on TV in ways no one had ever seen before. It Trojan horsed the most biting satire of the industry this side of Harlan Ellison into a bright, candy-colored cartoon the whole family could watch together.
Television! Teacher! Mother!
Secret lover.
It's just hard not to listen to TV. It spent so much more time raising us than you have.
By the way, I'm aware of the irony of appearing on TV in order to decry it, so don't bother pointing that out.
So even as a teenager, when I went through my angry TV sucks phase, I still watched The Simpsons because it agreed with me.
TV sucks.
And I know I wasn't alone. On The Simpsons ride, I admit I don't quite see that level of satire, but it's pretty damn close.
Sweetie, they won't kill you in an amusement park as long as you have a dime left in your pocket.
All the stops are pulled out to remind us how artificial, dysfunctional, and borderline fascist theme parks can be.
We're required to take an extensive training course
and not wear facial hair!
And no other theme park ride has ever so thoroughly acknowledged how much it sucks to wait in line.
Only 45 more minutes!
If the satire doesn't quite work, it's not because it was watered down, it's because the ride itself does its job too well. This is one of the most brilliantly intense motion simulators I've ever ridden, with all the awesome immersiveness of Back to the Future reprogrammed to replicate the sensation of pure cartoon chaos incarnate. It tells you how much theme parks suck while showing you precisely the opposite. And in the end, it's your decision which part you want to listen to. Will you get fed up with the park's more annoying aspects, or...
Let's go again!
So in the end, maybe it's not so bad for a theme park to hate itself. Just a little self-effacing humility can give it a sense of humor and force it to experiment now and then. Maybe even, God forbid, leave creative decisions to creative people. You certainly don't see too much of that from the evil bureaucratic alpha mouse in Hours Drive South.
There are very few things in pop culture that mean more to me than Back to the Future, but The Simpsons is one of them. And The Simpsons Ride is a worthy tribute to the greatest TV show of all time. And with that show about to wrap up its 83rd season with no end in sight, and syndication keeping it rerunning for centuries even if and when it does finally get canceled, like it or not, Springfield is here to stay.
Yeah, I miss its time-traveling predecessor as much as the next theme park fan, but... at least they replaced a 9 with a 9.5. And I know not everyone agrees with me. There's lots of people out there who consider this an abomination and wish Back to the Future was still here. And that's okay. Because after all, what Simpsons product could possibly be complete without fans complaining it was better 20 years ago? Until next time, I'm some jerk with a camera.
And a 1, and a 2, and a 3.
Boom, boom, boom.
Baby on board, how I'm adored. That sign on my car's window pane, bounce in my stem, loaded with hep, 'cause I'm driving in the car. My baby on board.
Can I help you?
We're the Universal employees that got fired for those blunders.
Oh. You're looking well?
Get up!
Yeah.